Good morning, and welcome to Coffee and Conversation. Hey, it's your boy D Rob. How's everybody doing this morning? Good. How was your week, guys? How was everybody's week? Let me get myself situated. How was everybody's week? You know, when we come to Coffee and Conversation, the aim here is to really bring value, right? And being able to reflect on our past week and identify some learning lessons so we can improve in life. See, my main goal is to help individuals identify their purpose and maximize their potential. And you do that through the growth process. So I'm here to help you advance your growth and your leadership. You know, I think it's imperative that we all advance and learn and advance and grow in life. So what's some things that this past week that you possibly have learned from? What's some lessons learned? And before we get into lessons learned, I want to know, did you get your cup of Joe? Everybody got their cup of Joe? I got mine. It's piping hot. Ooh, just how I like it. Make sure you got your cup of Joe. Nothing like coffee and conversation, right? And so that's what today's topic is. This is what we do here on Vision Leadership, is help individuals identify their purpose and draw and maximize their full potential. Hey, listen, if you haven't, please go to the YouTube channel, subscribe. So when I upload new videos, you can be first to get those videos. Be sure to hit the bell. Also, you can find your boy on Facebook at Dwayne Roberts Business Page. Or if you want additional information, always check out my webpage at DwayneHRoberts.com. I want to share my screen, you know. Let's see. And I might need to share computer sound too while I do this, right? That's right. Let me make sure my pick ain't in the way, right? So, coffee and conversations, lessons learned for the week. What have you learned this past week is my question. And how are we advancing our leadership, which is a bigger question. So for me this past week, this is what I've learned. This past week, I had an opportunity to talk to some good friends of mine. And we had some real good dialogue, right? Conversation, and really appreciate them for their transparency, their honesty, authenticity, you know. And it made me think when I was reflecting, because I have my journal, right? And so each night I reflect on what I learned the day before. And as I was revisiting my journal, and typically I don't write in my journal on Fridays because that's my downtime, right? And so, but I was reflecting back in my journal, and just so happened, and I put very little notes or reminders for my journal on Fridays, right? And I read the note that said, lessons learned, right? And I start reflecting back on this past week of what I learned. And I realized how I myself valued friendship, how I valued relationships, right? And so I wonder, how we are as leaders in our communities, on our jobs, in our homes, with our friends, who are we valuing, and how are we valuing these individuals that come into our lives, right? Let me see, Man, this thing here is killing me. There we go. Hope you guys get this. So how are we valuing friendships, right? That's my piece. Trying to figure how Yeah, that might be a little better. I hope that's better. How are we valuing friendships? Right? So the first thing I started with was, what is a friend? Well, what does that look like? Right? So I found that a friend is a person that is united to another by feelings of affection, loyalty, who is supportive, and who you socially interact with, right? The word friend comes from the old English word friend, I guess, right? Which means friend, lover, relative, or friend. Let's say it that way, right? Which means to love. Now, I'm sorry, I don't speak old English, and some of these words are a little tricky for you, boy, right? But listen to the meaning of this particular word. It means friend, lover, or relative, but it means to love. The same in the Greek word as the word friend is philos, right? A term of endearment. Now, where have you heard this word philos before? See, in America, we have the city of Philadelphia, which is the city of brotherly love. And in our communities, we have philanthropists. Yep, I said that right? Philanthropists who come through, who support organizations and nonprofits by their giving. The particular word philanthropy means to love the love of man and benevolence, right? There's something sticking out here about this particular word friend that I keep hearing over and over, and I'm sure you're catching it right about now. That is love. To be a friend is to love. So if that's the case, what is friendship? Friendship is a reciprocal relationship between two people. Friendship is a mutual emotion based on whether you're liking or philos, you loving. The Greek word, which means to the joy of being together and tender affection, right? As a mature friendship also includes agape love. There it is again. We're hearing this repetitive word, love, right? The Greek word agape means a commitment to seek the highest good for another. So your friendship is an act of love that seeks to commit to the highest good of another. I got to write that down, guys. I don't know about you. If you got your pen and paper, absolutely write that down. So I didn't write it down earlier, but as I say it again, it stands out to me. So friendship or friends, having friends, hearing some communication. Okay, I'll make sure everything was going good. I was hearing some feedback. All right, so friendship. It's that of love and a commitment to seek the highest good for another. I really like that that explanation, right? So Robert Stevenson said this: so long as we love, we serve. No man is useless while he is a friend. Hold on, let me read it again, because that word pops up again. So as long as we love, we serve. Your friendship is your ability to serve and love that gains you gains you some usefulness as a friend. So as long as we love, we serve, and no man is useless while he is a friend. I want to stop and ask you, what kind of friend are you being? What kind of relationships have you been building? Are you the type of friend that that go out of your way for your friends or for others. Let's just say it that way, for others. Oftentimes, many of us struggle with our friendships. You know, we look for others to reciprocate their love, their affection, their care, their concern, their friendship, right? And if we don't get that reciprocation back, oftentimes we walk away from that friendship, or that friendship could easily die off. Guys, I got to turn off. I don't know why. My wife got this heat on. I know why, because it's cold outside. Give me a second. Let me cut this heat down. All right, I'm sorry about that. I'm back. But I had to get that. That thing was on 78 in here. I don't know what the temp is outside, but it's hot. I got this jacket on. And y'all always see me. That's because I'm going. We go exercise after this, right? So let me get back to this place and point, right? So what kind of friend are we building or looking to be? How are we extending ourselves in the efforts to support others is my question, right? Are we building new relationships? And are we not only building new relationships, but are we adding value to those people that we love and serve? That's a powerful question. Powerful question, right? Food for thought, really. Food for thought. Let's get to that next slide. There we go. So, John 15, 10 and 12 reads, and it says, "If you obey my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed the Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you." Man, when I was thinking about this thing about friendship, and I started unraveling this word that I kept seeing repeat itself over and over and over in the effects of being a friend or being friendly or building upon friendship, was the fact that of love. Listen, the first two commandments of the Bible, it says, love the God with all our heart. And the second says, love your neighbor as yourself. Listen, you can't be a friend without applying the actions of love. Man, you can't be a friend without applying the actions of love. So let's back that up just for a tad bit, and let's look at that from a different angle. So because in our leadership, when we're leading others, when we're building connections, when we want to work with teams, and we're coaching and mentoring others, it requires us to have an act of love and of service. How are you serving others if first you can't love them enough just for them being them? How can you serve others if you can't even consider how you can add value to their life? You know, it's one thing to be a friend so we can gain everything from everyone, but friendship ain't about gaining. It's about service. Friendship is about serving. So how are you serving in your leadership roles on your jobs? Now, I got it. Everybody on our job ain't going to be a friend, but nonetheless, going to get real interesting here. Nonetheless, they are, because there's levels to this. And we're going to talk about these levels here in a minute. Statistically, I found out that 1 in 5 millennials are lonely. That's what the polls say. Let me move my screen over just a little bit more, right? 1 in 5 millennials are lonely. The polls have taken over 1,200 adults, 18 years and older, found this. 27% of millennials have no close friends, while 27% of millennials have no friends, where 25% have no acquaintances. In essence, it's 1 in 5 millennials have no buddies at all. What's happening in our world today that's causing us not to have friends. Could it be social media, that we spend so much time on social media, gaining the likes and fake friends on the internet, where we have now become disconnected and not sociable in our surroundings, in our environments? It's more satisfactory to have friends on it, more friends on the internet, because some of you probably got about 3,000. Well, let's say it this way: anywhere between 1,000 to 5,000 friends on Facebook, on your different multimedia platforms. But how many friends can you really count on in the physical? You know, this is my belief. If you want to be friendly, you have to show yourself as a friend. You got to go out and build some connections. You got to begin to start connecting with some individuals. I got it. Social media has taken this world by storm. I understand COVID is out, ripping everybody a new look on fear. It's just crazy, right? You got police brutality at its highest, because I won't say finest, but it's at its highest. At least I'm looking at this thing, right? You got individuals that won't even speak to their neighbors. You know, I was having a conversation with a neighbor recently, and he asked me this question. So who is your neighbor? You know, and I looked in the community in which I live, and I said, what sucks? Everybody around me is my neighbor, right? And he didn't take too kindly to that, because he didn't see everybody as his neighbor. Some of us only see people as our neighbor because this is the individual that I associate with, or this is the individual I know, you know. I think life requires you to step outside yourself, to go a little further, do some things a little different, to extend your hand of friendship and brotherly love, philos, and love others with agape love. Showing yourself of service, being of service to others, be giving, supportive, whatever that may look like. And we don't have to stay in this small knit community of friends that we grew up with as childhood friends, or some new friends that we learned to personally connect with today because we have like-mindedness, or because we share some same values, or we simply enjoy each other's company. But we have to take our friendship to a different level. Hold on, I think somebody just checked the chat real quick. Somebody might have just sent me all right, cool. That's what's up. So there we go. Get back to the screen. Yeah. How did I lose that? I read that. There we go. Okay, there we go. So I want to talk about this: three levels of friendship. Now, I'm sure some of you know this already, but I still find it interesting that there's levels in our friendship. It's on levels in our commitment to others. There's levels how we build upon our friendship, right? So in essence, some of us have some casual friends. These casual friends we connect with occasionally. We have some common interests. We share some common characteristics, or have common character. We share a little bit of our personal problems, but there's no accountability in that essence of friendship. We see each other in passing and in going, right? We're just casual friends. Then we have those who we consider to be close friends. We have regular contact with them. We have shared interests and activities together. We comfort them, or they comfort us during our times of trials and sorrows. And we add limited accountability to our friendship, meaning we want to hold one another accountable and maintaining this relationship. And then we have the committed friend, right? We spend quality time together. We have mutual values. We have life goals. We have the freedom to correct, to help or correct the character flaws in life. There's 100%, I would say probably maybe 99.1% transparency there, right? We got 100% transparency, but we are 100% committed and invested in this relationship, right? And oftentimes these committed relationships are or could be the relationships between man and woman in as far as marriage is concerned. Maybe you built this with friends in your community that you just enjoy being, and you're single, let's say it that way, and you're single, and you just love being around their company, right? And y'all spend a lot of time together, and you have built this strong, unbreakable bond. Those are those committed relationships that we see. So there's levels to the mere fact of being a friend and having friendship. But this is what interests me. Jesus managed different levels of friendships. See, Jesus too had casual friends. You know, his casual friends looked in the like of the tax collectors and maybe other sinners. See, if you read Luke 7:34, he talks about how they were judging him for hanging out with the tax collectors and sinners. Jesus had some close friends, and we know these particular close friends to be the disciples. Maybe even Mary and Martha in his life were some close friends that Jesus had. And as well as Jesus had some committed friends. And understanding his committed friends, we think of the three apostles, Peter, James, and John. See, if you look over in Mark 14:33, when Jesus was going into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray, he took Peter, James, and John with him, and he asked them, he said, wait here and pray while I go further, you know? So our committed friends will take with us on journeys. Our committed friends are individuals that walk the walk with us, understand our strengths, and understand our limitations in life, and who will go the distance, right? Who will go the distance for you, right? So even Jesus himself had casual friendships. He had close friendships as well as committed friendships. So for some of you who want to ignite some friendships, maybe you one in five, of those millennials who struggle with building friendships. You're too attached to your devices. Haven't taken time out to build up the community of people or connect with the community of people around you, and you want to ignite the flame of friendship in your life. Listen, I like this. Iron sharpens iron, so man sharpens another, Proverbs 2:17. So if you're an individual who wants to ignite the flame of friendship in life, realize one, that recognize that you need wise friends. See, he who walks with the wise grows wise, but a company of fools suffer harms, Proverbs 13:20. Your ability to identify wise individuals of life and true friendship is developed where there's it's reciprocated, where you can grow and add value not only to others, but they do the same for you in your life. Two, realize that in your ability to ignite the flame of friendship, it requires you to look for others who are looking or need a friend. See, the word says that each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also in the interests of others. Philippians 2:4. You know, You want to be a friend, you have to show yourself friendly. And in your ability to look for others that may be friendless, you befriend them, be kind, love on them, serve them. And last, to ignite the flame of friendship, be approachable. Add a smile. And smile at others. Yeah, your boy got a big smile on his face. Why? Because I remember the times in life where I walked around with a frown. And well, at least that's what people thought, right? And people would ask me, is everything all right? And I'd be like, no, I'm cool. Everything's good. And they would say to me, you're not smiling. Well, today I want to tell you, I smile. you know, because a happy heart makes the face cheerful, but a heartache crushes the spirit, Proverbs 15, 13. Today I am happy because I realize and understand that for me to add value to others requires me to be a friend, requires me to love others as myself and put their needs above my own so I can be of service to them. You want to improve your leadership? Listen, become a friend. Become a true friend to others. So I want to close and leave you with this. Instead of focusing on getting friendships, likes on Facebook, on your social media platforms, I encourage you to focus on being a friend. Go out in your communities today. It's there you'll find the joy and significance that will be found in serving and befriending others as an extension of God's love. See, because to be a friend or to ignite friendship in the life, in your life, you must first recognize that one, you need friends, you need wise friends, and two, you're looking for others in need of a friend, and three, be approachable and smile. Yep. Be approachable and smile. So what's your thoughts on any of this? You know, I love to hear what you have to say and get your feedback about how you can apply this friendship, this brotherly love, this agape love, this ability to serve others in your organizations, within your community, as well as in your home. We as leaders must strive to become much more Christ-like. You know, I say it that way. Be much more Christ-like, right? And apply friendship in our growth and our ability to grow and our ability to expand our leadership. We must be a friend. Hey, I'm your boy, D-Rob. As always, it's a pleasure to chat and talk with you guys and come together for coffee and conversation. Let me check the chat real quick. See where you at. All right, no chats. So, as I always say, hey, you can check Dwayne Roberts' Facebook business page. There you'll find more videos. You can get great content, as well as you can go to DwayneHRoberts.com. There you can schedule a 15-minute consultation call with me, or be part of the community. Add your input. Let us know how we can help others identify their purpose and draw to their full potential. I got it all. Well, as till next time, I just want to say thank you and God bless.